Welcome to Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. Thanks to Lady Bird Johnson, wildflowers have a special place in our hearts. And if you can believe it, now's the time to plant our spring bloomers. Today we'll show you how to do it. On tour, let's visit a family that found a special way to renew life through wildflowers.
Ellen and Nick Brumder have taken many journeys in their life together. The most meaningful is the one that inspired them to create a cemetery open to all, among nature's symbols of resurrection and healing. It's a family endeavor of three generations who find joy in the land and wanted to protect and share its solace.
We believe that there are great healing powers from nature, just spending time out in the silence, enjoying the birds and the flowers, and we see that healing take place as people walk and tend the graves.
The land, stretching for 20 acres beyond a small house, is pure and untouched.
So natural, as if it had been developed over the last million years, and we were latecomers to the project.
Respecting its legacy, the Brumders are careful to preserve it. Their daughter Julia's husband, Alex Grubbs, is a naturalist who recognizes the soil-borne gifts and gently adds to them. He also leads plant walks to acquaint others with natives and their cultivation. Nick, a renowned artist blacksmith, and Holly Kincannon, an architectural designer and sculptor, design the master plan. At the center, on a hilltop overlooking the burial gardens, Nick designed the Resurrection Cross. He and Holly are among a team of 11 artisans who design the memorials, each one handcrafted and unique. For uplifting continuity and to celebrate resurrection, they use white or pale stone. Instead of plastic flowers, families scatter seeds or plant their loved ones' favorites. Many come every day for the comfort of rebirth as they watch new life emerge.
We see this incredible, beautiful parallel between the healing of the earth and the healing of the soul, and we can read this in the family's faces.
Families come all hours of the day, every day of the week.
One of our families that has a child buried here, they became our caretakers, and they open and close the gates and give the cemetery a very caring touch.
Some visitors just want to enjoy the peaceful setting. For most, that includes a walk in the woods. Eagle Scout Robbie Pribula cleared and mulched a trail for the prayer path of St. Francis. Eagle Scout Tyler Burr created a native plant guide to identify the specimens along the Walk of the Beatitudes. Among the sanctuary of the trees, families discover the healing power of water. In a cove beside the pond, the Mother Teresa Grotto hosts family meals after services and welcomes guests anytime for serene contemplation. Among the flowers, throughout the year, families gather for festivities and picnics. For Ellen and Nick, it's been a journey of hard work and dedication. In helping others find peace in their journey through nature's rebirth, they share a profound goal.
To bring back the cemetery as a place of refreshment where we can ponder not only on the lives of those that we've lost, but our own mortality and kind of put life in perspective through being in the silence of nature, I think is a very, people are drawn to that. It's just very intimate and rewarding work for us.
I love that video. Such beautiful springtime sights. And right now we're going to be telling you how you can brighten up your springtime with wildflowers and native plants from the Wildflower Center. I'm joined by Andrea DeLong-Amaya, and
Hello.
It's always a pleasure to have you on the program.
Thanks for having me.
And we're going to be talking about the sale at the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center, which is coming
yes.
up, a big fall sale, plus lots of different plants that people should be considering in this year of drought.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think a lot of us have lost a lot of plants over the mm-hmm. summer, and so now's a great time to start moving into some of the more drought-resistant native plants.
I hear, I can't tell you how much I've been hearing that this year. People have finally had it.
Yeah.
With a non-durable plant, and they really want to move to the natives. Let's start off by talking about the fun stuff. The sale's coming up. This is always a big event.
Yeah, and it's going to be October 10th and 11th, the weekend, and our members only preview sales the Friday before, and it'll be on the weekend, it'll be 9 to 5, as it's been, and we have a plant list up on our website, so go to wildflower.org and find the species list that we'll be continuously updating, but that's really great.
Yeah.
Pre-shop.
Well, and some of the things that you have are really rare, and this is going to be one of the only opportunities to buy some of these different plants. So
yeah,
I really encourage
that. That's one of the exciting things about our plant sales. We offer so many local native plants. We have about 300 species that we'll have for sale this time around. So
that's
impressive. All the stuff that you can't find necessarily in other places.
Okay. Well, and you know, one of the things, the fall is a busy time at the Wildflower Center, and it, traditionally this is when I think of always time to plant the wildflowers,
right? Yeah, absolutely. Now through the winter, really, and planting wildflowers from seed is a great time to do that right now, especially since we've had some early fall rains. Hopefully the ground will get moist and we'll continue to have rains, so we'll keep our fingers crossed on that.
Right. let's keep that hope alive,
and we will have seeds for sale at the plant sale as well.
Oh, great, great. So plants and seeds. Now, when it comes to seeding out, that's the easiest way for so many of the wildflowers, but certain preparation work is required, really. I won't say required, but a good idea. Bigger return on your investment if you do this kind of stuff. Let's talk about just site preparation first. Yeah. Say you have a site that you want to turn over to like a wildflower meadow. Mm-hmm. What's the first step?
Well, if there's any existing vegetation, you want to make sure you can clear it out, or at least, you know, save particular things, but have a lot of open soil, because that's probably the most important thing to do with wildflower seeding, is you need to have good soil to seed contact.
So open spaces, where you see the ground exposed.
Yeah, and mostly you want to do it in a sunny spot, but there are some species that actually will tolerate some shade. Actually, this is a tropical sage that's a good shade tolerant plant. So there are a few things that you can do for a shady meadow too, but you have the biggest selection of sunny stuff.
Yeah, yeah. So again, clear it out a little bit, expose the soil, and some of the seeds, you know, we hear this phrase scarifying, and particularly with the bluebonnets. Sometimes it helps to do a little preparation on the seed themselves, right?
Yeah, you could. If you've never had bluebonnets in a patch before and you're doing them to start out with fresh, if you scarify them, you'll have more germination the first year. Now, if you don't scarify them, some of the seeds won't germinate the first year, but over the time, their seed coats will wear off and you'll have them come up years later. So it just depends on, you know, if you want a lot the first year or, you know, wait until they come up the next year. And then ideally, you'll let them reseed. You know, let them ripen before you cut them, and they'll fall back onto the ground, and you'll have a good seed bank coming up.
I don't even worry about it. With bluebonnets, I just toss them out, and it's like, okay, that seed will last for 20 years. That's okay.
That's right.
And if I'm really, really convinced I want a big show of bluebonnets, I just throw out more seed.
Right. I think that's the easiest way. Yeah. But if you do want to scarify them, one of the ways we do it, and this sounds so bizarre that you would do this to a plant, take the seeds and we freeze them, and then we take them like overnight, and then take them out and pour boiling water over them and let them soak, and they'll swell up, and you know that they're absorbing that water, and then you can put the seeds out.
Yeah.
Another thing that a lot of people have heard about is needing to get some sort of inoculation of them, and I don't know if there's any inoculant that's commercially available, but what we've done is if we're putting bluebonnets into a space that have never had them before, we mix in a little bit of soil that was growing them, and that gives you that microflora.
Okay, so the little microbes that are really help with the germination of the seeds.
Yeah.
Okay, one other thing about seeding is sometimes you get these seeds that are so tiny. I mean, they look like
little
smaller
dust.
Than, you know, like exactly dust is a good way to describe it. How do you seed that out efficiently? What's a good strategy for seeding that out?
Yeah, mixing it with some kind of sand or some kind of medium that can dilute it, and then you can more easily spread that out more evenly. Sand is kind of nice because you can see it, but it can be really anything that you'd want to put on your ground.
Yeah,
and then
a
you don't
compost,
if the seeds are that small, you also don't want to bury them.
Right, right. Yeah, that's a very good point. On a lot of these, you don't really bury them all. You just kind of toss them out there.
Maybe rake them in a little bit.
I used to always wait until this time of year. And if I'd see a storm front approaching where they were promising, absolutely promising, that's when I would go out and do it.
Perfect. That would be perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's talk about some of the plants that are going to be available at the sale, because I know people are going to want to pick up a lot of these. And some of these you're not going to want a seed like this like this one right here.
Yeah.
And this is, I love the Havardiana agave. This is, whenever I think of Big Bend, I think of this plant.
That's what you see mostly there, and they're spectacular.
Yeah.
And they do very well for us here in Central Texas, mm-hmm. as long as you give them really good drainage. That's the main thing. And if you don't want to irrigate at all, they're fine with that.
This is an agave, obviously, and this one will get pretty big, really. 4 to 5 feet tall, right?
Yeah, the flower stalks can get really tall.
Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. That's a rare occurrence, but but it will happen from time to time.
Actually, I think they can even get like 20 feet tall when the flower stalks. Yeah.
So you can see well-armed Havardiana agave, and you know, again, not something you typically see a lot in the stores. So this is going to be an opportunity for people to pick up a plant that is really unusual. It's a classic Texas plant, though, and I love the coloration on this—the pale color with the dark teeth. Mm-hmm. Really, really beautiful. Now, another one that is going to be available, this is, I think, maybe my all-time favorite native flower, the claret cup a cactus. And this, I'm going to take this little guy out of here because so that people can see the form. The forms of the plants are super cool.
Yeah.
But the bloom on this one is spectacular.
Yeah, a lot of the cacti are very showy when they're blooming, and this is a spectacular, rich, bright orange. And, mm-hmm. you know, the flowers are, I don't know, 3 to 4 inches in diameter.
Yeah.
And a mature plant will have lots of flowers. They're mostly spring bloomers, but they are spectacular.
You may have noticed, but I like the color orange.
Orange.
And not just because of this either, but anyway, great little plant, claret cup cactus, and I hope people will look for that. Now, here's a plant I have never gardened with. But, you know, once you see this flower close up, it's unmistakable that it's a plumbago.
Right.
And this is just, we call this white plumbago. Is that the common name for
it? White plumbago, yeah.
Okay.
Plumbago scandens, because there are other white plumbagos that are different.
Okay, and this is a native.
Yeah, it's native to South Texas, and we have had really great luck growing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little slow to get established, but what's really cool about them are these beautiful white flowers really all summer long.
Mm-hmm.
And then the new foliage in the spring, and then the foliage in the fall when it starts getting cold, it turns bright burgundy.
Ah.
So you have the white flowers with the burgundy foliage, and that is really spectacular.
Yeah, that's a great combo.
And then it just makes a low, moundy plant about 2 to 3 feet tall mm-hmm. and spreads.
Well, you know, the plumbagos that I'm aware of are plants that are pretty well adapted to shade.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is this one that is going to grow in the shade for us?
It'll take, considerable shade. It'll probably have a little better red coloring on the foliage and more sun, but it'll bloom fine in some shade.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. So this is, again, the little native plumbago scandens.
That's right.
White plumbago by another name, and will be available to sale.
Mm-hmm.
And we have just a little baby guy here, but I think we have some images of the mature plant. And you call this heartleaf hibiscus, right?
Yeah, heartleaf hibiscus. Also, I've heard it called tulipan del monte,
mm-hmm.
The tulip of the mountains, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's a hibiscus family plant.
Mm-hmm. Obviously a hibiscus family plant.
Nice, with soft, velvety leaves.
Yeah.
And then the flowers are also brilliant, saturated red. It's really a scarlet flower. And also, for some of these things that we don't have photographs of, I encourage people to look at our website, and we have a whole image gallery and a plant database where you can find out all sorts of information about bloom period, color, how big the plant gets,
where to plant it, all of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, that's one of the real great benefits of the Wildflower Center.
And that's another one that will tolerate some shade, too.
Yeah, and this is, we have a little shade grouping here, in fact, because the next plant is what you were pointing out earlier, which is the little Salvia coccinea, or tropical sage. Again, bright red color, great hummingbird plant.
Yeah.
I love the little flowers on this. And this is one that, this was actually one of the very first native plants I ever seeded out, just throwing out seed.
It's an easy one, which is nice. I mean, it's, you know, if you're a new gardener, seeding them out or planting them from pots, either way, they're pretty good. They'll reseed on their own over time.
Quite aggressively.
Yeah, pretty freely. but they're also very shade tolerant, and they have a really long bloom period, too, pretty much spring through the frost.
Right.
You'll sometimes see them in white. You can find them in white or pink, but the standard is the red.
Yeah.
And they make a nice shrubby plant about three to 4 feet tall. And what I like to do is periodically trim them back so they stay a little bushier and more compact.
Yeah, and they take very well to that and maintain a nice form. If you just, very light touch, once they've kind of gone through that first blush of bloom, just pinch them back a little
bit. I've seen people be pretty brutal and cut them pretty much to the ground even sometimes.
Yeah.
You don't want to go further than the lowest leaves, but the tops are good. They come out really bushy.
I remember seeing pictures of lawns of this mode, which actually quite spectacular. If you let them go at just the right moment, they all bloom.
Pretty plant.
Now this is the bluebell, the eustoma. And this is the Texas bluebell, and this is one that you're going to have at this
sale. We have a lot of them in these 4-inch pots, which is a perfect size to try them. This is one that has the dust-sized seeds, so planting them from seed can be expensive, and it's kind of hard to get them going, but if you can start with a plant, that's often a good way to go.
Now, the leaf on this one is smooth and gray, which tells me that this is not for the shade.
No, right. It's definitely a full sun plant.
Yeah, this is obviously an adaptation for
And they're sort of succulent.
Them. Yeah.
They're really succulent leaves,
right,
too. And that's one that needs full sun, and they bloom in the middle of summer when a lot of other things aren't blooming, with a very large purple flower. They're very stunning.
Okay, real showy little plants. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's going to be a lot of availability of all sorts of cool things. Real briefly, I just want to mention that you brought one of the, you're still branding them with the coupierias, the little rain lily next to you. They'll be available. This has been a spectacular year for those.
Yes.
I know that people love being able to purchase some of those. Real briefly, again, very briefly, the sale's coming up on?
Yes, October 10th and 11th, and we'll be open from 9 to 5 at the Wildflower Center. And check our website for more details at wildflower.org.
Okay, great, Andrea. Thank you, as always, for coming on. I know that people are going to be very anxious to get out there and get their goodies.
Me too. I'm ready for fall planting myself.
Okay, thanks so much. Coming up next, it's our County Extension agent here. Thanks.
Hi, and welcome to Down to Earth. Our question this week is on fertilizing, especially roses and other perennials. Those plants are getting ready to go dormant, and I know you're getting ready to go out there into the garden and start working. With the cooler temperatures, you might see some invigoration on those plants right now. They've had a really hard summer and they've been stressed, and so you see them wake up a little bit. So you might want to go out there and start to fertilize them and work with them a little bit. And that's actually a great idea. But if you do that, you do want to be careful about what type of fertilizer you use. Anything that's high in nitrogen will help those plants grow any green growth, and that's not what you want to encourage right now. You want to encourage the plants to go to sleep a little bit. So what you want to do is help them make roots, and a low amount of nitrogen in your fertilizer will do that. Or even something like compost. If you want to add compost around your beds and use it kind of as a mulch, maybe scrape back your mulch if you have your beds mulched, and put in some compost right around there. And that will break down slowly this winter, and that's a really good way to fertilize your beds right now. If you didn't prune those roses back in the late summer to reinvigorate them and get a few blooms, you might do a little bit of light pruning now, and then let the plants go dormant, let them lose their leaves, and come into the winter and in January or so start to prune them for their spring growth. Our plant of the week this week is a vegetable, and it's a very beautiful vegetable, Swiss chard. Many, many varieties of Swiss chard are out there, and a few of them do really well in our environment. And one that I would like to see us plant more actually in the landscape is bright lights. This particular Swiss chard has a lot of different color in it, and the petioles are just beautiful in the garden. So you can actually tuck those in where you might have had summer annuals, and between your perennials that are going dormant for the winter. Put that beautiful vegetable into your garden and use it like you would a landscape plant. And then you get the extra benefit of harvesting that and having it through the winter in your salads. To do this month, you want to start shopping for spring flowering bulbs. You can order those from catalogs now. You might be able to get them in the nurseries. And if you want to do that, now's a great time to shop so you get the colors and the cultivars that you want for your garden. You don't want those to sell out, or to go ahead and buy them late, and then they'll be sort of spent in the nurseries if you buy them late in the season. You also still have time to plant some cool season vegetables. You want to do that as transplants rather than putting seeds out into the garden at this point. Something like lettuce or spinach, and your broccoli, your kale, and of course your Swiss chard. You can also plant cool season flowering annuals. One of my favorite with a beautiful scent is snapdragons, sweet peas, wildflowers, still time for wildflowers, and your pansies. and you want to turn your compost pile. After all the heat we had this summer, we saw that our compost piles might have been slowing down if you weren't watering them enough. But you also might have noticed after that heavy rain that we had, if you got a lot of rain like many people did, that your compost started to slow down at that point because it actually was too wet. So if you haven't turned that in the last month or so, go ahead and turn that up so you can get that going again. For more tips or to get in touch with your extension office to ask us a question for a future show, visit klru.org/ctg.
Thanks, Daphne. Now let's check in with Trisha Shirey for Backyard Basics.
It's really difficult sometimes to have a beautiful garden and to have pets in our yard. And dogs can be a real challenge when it comes to keeping gardens. They have their ways of patrolling the yard and running through things and playing, and there's nothing they like better than a good pile of compost or organic fertilizer to roll in so that they smell the same way. But over the years, I've found some ways to deal with gardening and have dogs too. And I've had dogs that are very easily trained. I was able to put stakes and string out around the perimeter of my garden. And Jessie learned very quickly that she was not supposed to go inside the stakes and string. And after a while, she learned how to walk between the rows of the garden and was definitely a great garden companion. I haven't had a dog since that was that easily trained, so I've decided that good fences make a better relationship with my pets. It is a good idea to keep in mind where dogs have their paths. If your dogs run the perimeter of the fence and that's just their way of doing things, it's probably best not to put a garden next to that fence. Just leave their paths and you'll notice where they spend a lot of time. Those are probably not your best locations for a garden. In fact, in the pathways, I just put some mulch down and make sure that that stays mulch so it's not a muddy mess. If you have an area next to the fence where you want to have plants and your dogs use that as a runway, maybe put those shrubs a little bit further away from the fence so the dogs still have access because they're doing their thing. They're guarding the perimeter of the property and watching out for strangers, and that's their job. So we'll let them do their job. Now, when you're mulching, make sure you're not using cocoa shell mulch that can have caffeine and theobromine that can be toxic to dogs. So stay away from that particular mulch, but any shredded native will work. One of the fence materials that I really like to use is this galvanized farm fencing. It comes in widths of 4 feet and 6 feet, actually heights of 4 feet and 6 feet, and then it comes in 20-foot lengths. It has 4x4 openings, or you can buy it with 4x6 openings, but if you have very small dogs, they could go through that. But it's very easy to use, and I use it to just go around my entire vegetable garden so that I have wooden stakes, wooden posts, and the fencing is attached to that, and then it becomes a trellis for my cucumbers and my beans, so that works out beautifully. But even in some of my beds that surround the house where dogs like to dig and bury themselves and make a hole in the flower beds, I've just put this up as edging along the fences. I tried some of the store-bought folding edging and attractive edging, but my dogs jumped over that. I found that I need about 30 inches to keep Zoe out of the flower bed. So with this, I can cut it to whatever height I need. And I use these green metal posts. They come in different lengths. And you'll put those in with either a hammer or a fence post hammer, a special fence post device. And I'll put a sock or a pad over the top so that I don't dent the top and or knock the paint off so that it rusts. And you'll want to invest in a good pair of bolt cutters. You can also rent these to cut your fencing. But if you buy a 6 foot height fence, you can cut that in half and get 40 feet out of one piece of fencing. I use zip ties for putting the fence on, or you could use a plastic flexible tie that you can take on and off. So if you need to get in that garden bed and do some digging or replanting, you just pull the fencing off of the posts and then you can put it back on when you're ready to use it. Another issue I've had with my dogs is they're digging under the fence to get out. And of course you can put rocks under the fence to deal with that. But what I found works best is to use pieces of this fencing again, but this time I put it flat on the ground. I trim the grass really short and pin this to the ground with long soil staples. And that way the grass comes up through. It's very easy for me to weed eat along the fences, but the dogs can't go in. And I actually extend it on either side of the fence so that way dogs from the outside can't be digging under the fence to get in, or your neighbor's dogs can't dig under either. So that works really well. I've even used leftover pieces like this that are only 12 inches tall as an armadillo fence, and it actually worked pretty well to keep the dillos out of the yard. So you can make your garden still look great and keep your dogs happy as well, just with a little extra work.
Check out klru.org/CTG for more tips, online video, and our weekly blog. Next week, tune in for insight from Lauren and Scott Ogden. Until then, I'll see you in the garden.
Visit klru.org/CTG to learn more about today's program, upcoming events, and to sign up for our electronic newsletter. Check out John's how-to tips and visit Trisha's Corner for ideas inside and out. Get growing at klru.org/CTG.